think that the person sitting to my left is familiar to many of you, if not most of you, perhaps even all of you. And but for if there's even a single person in the audience who might not know who he is, he's Soren Skou. He's the CEO of AP Moller-Maersk. And we're delighted, Soren, that you could be with us today. You traveled all the way from Copenhagen, not a short flight. We appreciate you making the effort to be here. Soren is not some, fixer from outside the maritime industry brought in to turn around a container line. He's been 36 years with Maersk, starting in the early 1980s. He became the CEO just of the line in 2012. And prior to that, you had run Maersk Tankers for quite some time, and you most recently became the head of the group, and in that role, you have orchestrated an extraordinary transformation, even up to today. Not even talking about where you're going to be going. You sold off Maersk Oil. You sold off Maersk Tankers to the parent company, but it's not part of AP Moller-Maersk anymore. It's part of the family. You said in your earnings call 10 days ago that you're moving ahead with spinning off Maersk Drilling. All of which is part of you might even say radical transformation of the company. Why?
Well, thanks, Peter, and thanks for having me, and thanks for starting by reminding me how old I am. We are going through a real transformation in Maersk. It's a much used word these days, and can mean anything from a change management project or a new IT system to actually what we are doing, which is moving away from being a conglomerate. When I became the CEO, we had 8 different divisions. We were in a multiple of industries, but we have decided to focus.
Yeah, maybe you can talk into that.
We have decided to focus entirely on.
Maybe you can hold it closer. So. There you go. We want to make.
We have decided to focus our company entirely on container shipping, container ports, and container logistics. And the reason for why we want to do that, that's because we believe that's where the growth, the profitable growth, will come from in the future. Simple as that.
Yeah. And what is the vision that you have? I mean, the idea of you've spoken about becoming an integrator of container logistics, and integrator is a known term in the transportation world. It refers, prior to you taking on that term for your company, it applied to UPS, it applied to FedEx, it applied to DHL, integrating the entire end-to-end. And so tell me about that vision. What is the opportunity there that you see?
We've spent, as Maersk Line and as a container carrier industry, we've spent probably the last 30, 40 years making it more and more cost-effective to move a container from one end of the world to the other. And that means, frankly, that today, in absolute numbers, the freight rates are a lot lower than they were in the 80s. And we've absorbed 30, 40 years of inflation in addition. Of course, that has been a big benefit for our customers. But what we haven't spent a lot of time on, frankly, it has been to figure out how to make it easier and simpler to ship containers. And when we have talked to the customers, there are clearly a lot of pain points identified in terms of the complexity, the unreliability, the lack of transparency in shipping containers around the world. And that's what we are first and foremost trying to address.
So is it what is the importance then that the control of information, the ability to aggregate information and data and provide that to customers? How crucial is that to your vision?
Our industry, just like any other industry in the world today, have to respond to or even drive some trends around digitization. I think our digitization will impact our industry in a number of different ways. First and foremost, it's going to change dramatically the way we transact just do the daily business. You know, away from email, away from phone calls, to more self-serve, more online, more instant. So, you know, we started this journey a few years ago, and today, basically, all of the prices that we disseminate are in a digital form. 90% of the quotes that we give are self-served online on Maersk.com. We take almost 99% of all bookings in an electronic form, more than half of them on the website, the rest through EDI and so on. The same goes for the process around documentation. And so we're moving transactions to a place where they are instant, 24/7, you know, multiple platforms. That's a customer benefit. It's going to make everybody more efficient. Things will be faster and so on. But digitization will also impact the industry in different ways. And one very important headline for me would be visibility. I'm sure that you know, 5 years from now, we'll have a whole different level of visibility in the supply chain. Not just where the physical container, where the cargo actually is, but actually also where all of the documents are in the process. And that's what we in our company have worked with together with IBM in this project we call Trade Lens, which is really about creating more visibility in the supply chain, both for the physical part and for the documentation part.
And how present in the day-to-day environment that you're just describing is on one hand prediction, the ability to predict to customers when things will arrive. And also, if you can accurately predict it, will you move in the direction of guaranteeing delivery? Will you feel more comfortable guaranteeing delivery and entering into those types of arrangements?
Well, if you see two important trends of the industry being what we just discussed, digitization and transparency or visibility, I think a third very important trend would be that we are moving towards defined products. And that will mean that, you know, you will have more of these standardized products. We already offer a standardized product in addition to the normal product, which is around we give a guarantee to load against the customer. We'll pay a fee if they don't show up. That's one product. But at this TPM, our sales team are really talking about four different ocean products. You know, basically, from we can roll you wherever we want, it's going to get there, but that's the lowest price to, you know, you'll always load and you'll get priority, and that's the highest price. So you'll see more of these products, and I'm sure that our industry will develop in that direction as well. So guaranteed delivery, sure, it's going to happen.
And do you, you know, one of the interesting things about what you're doing, and also you can see it to a certain degree of what CGM is doing, although they're going about it in a different way, is just the very concept of a container line being in the end-to-end business. I mean, this is not a new concept. I mean, if you were to go back to the, you know, the 1980s even, you had CSX when it owned Sealand, they had a barge line. They had CSX Logistics, and even you folks with Maersk Logistics, you know, in the earlier iteration, APL and APL Logistics, and you know, none of those visions really went anywhere. You know, in the case of, you know, CSX, I mean, you know, there was very little synergies that were created. I mean, in the case of the Maersk Logistics and the APL Logistics, you know, the APL Logistics business was sold. You know, Houston Logistics, you know, became very separate from NYK. You know, in your case, Damco, you know, you separated off to a certain extent the forwarding business. You know, what's different now?
I think a number of things are different today. We have already talked about visibility and digitization, but also an important factor is a third important trend, which is the degree of consolidation. So we, in Maersk now, we have 17-18% global market share, and that means that we actually have a size where, you know, we can be relevant for customers just shipping with us. And you've seen the industry consolidate. I'm sure you're going to see more of that, and that will also mean that
you know, more and more customers
can rely on us to also offer end-to-end solutions.
Mm-hmm. And would there be more? I guess the digital opportunity, the opportunity to digitize your business, is that playing a role in something that's different now versus, you know, back in the 80s or 90s or 2000s when, you know, this idea was tried in the past?
So digital does give us the opportunity to have more visibility in the supply chain from end to end. So for instance, the concept in TradeLens is quite simple, that, you know, all the relevant participants in a transportation of a container is hooked up to the platform and deliver events. So tracking of the container, where is it? And you know, that wasn't possible 10 or 15 or 20 years ago. So we have some technology that can lend itself to providing more of an end-to-end solution. I mean, when you ship a package with UPS, you also track it if you want to, through all the various distribution centers, and feel that you have a measure of control in that way. So that is a new capability. But I think equally important is the fact that we have the consolidation.
Yeah. And actually, that UPS example that you just gave is a good question, because it raises a good issue. Because, you know, if I track something on UPS, you know, I don't have to pay for it. And it gets to the question of our, you know, it's sort of the eternal question of container line businesses, is how do you create economic value and then be compensated for that? Mm. Where is the value that can be created and how do you be compensated for that in ways that you haven't been able to achieve before?
Look, I'm sure that our customers, and that doesn't matter whether they're importers or exporters or logistics providers, will get value out of more visibility. We will get more value out of visibility. I mean, if we have a global telephone system, and we actually track why people call us, and the single most asked question at our customer service center is, where's my container? And frankly, you know, if I can have people do that online or feed the data straight into their system, I'll save cost. Yeah. So I think there's plenty of opportunity for value creation and therefore also value capture. Obviously, I don't think we're going to be able to charge for telling people where their container is, but there may certainly be very, you know, more detailed information that can provide value also to us.
Yeah. Okay. Good. And another question, just that comes up, is, you know, when people look at your company, you know, Maersk has had you know, different strategies over the years, different visions. And has, to a certain degree, known in the market as kind of going this way, then, you know, kind of going that way. And so is there something different about this time now? Is this a more of a permanent change versus a strategy that you may decide at some point, well, that's not working, and then go do something else?
So when I became the CEO of Maersk Line in 2012, the company was in a different place, and the most important difference was, at the time, we were also the largest carrier at that time, not as big as we are today, but we were the largest carrier, but we were nowhere near being the most profitable carrier. We basically didn't have competitive margins, and that was, in my view, because we had a cost problem. So we spent a lot of time, 3-4 years, really whipping the company into shape so that we, you know, on a reasonably consistent basis, is in the top ranks when it comes to level of profitability. That has enabled us to acquire Hamburg Süd and so on. But what was also pretty clear after 3 or 4 years of focus on cost was that when we looked at our customers, they weren't too happy. When we look at our net promoter scores and so on, we were not happy with what we saw. And that really led us to start thinking about how do we become more of a customer-centric company, how do we deal with some of the real customer pain points, and that's really what has been at the forefront when we have built the new strategy.
Yeah. Okay. Well, when you talk about customers, there's really two segments of customers. There's you know, direct cargo customers, and then there's intermediaries. And when you announced recently that you acquired a customs broker, which was maybe not a huge transaction, but nevertheless was seemed enormously significant in terms of your vision. How should forwarders feel about the direction that you're going in? Should they look at you as a competitor now?
No, I mean we forwarders make up probably 40 or 45% of our book of business today, and I don't see why we shouldn't be able to have that also in the future. As we digitize the company, we can help all forwarders become more efficient. And if there's one thing that matters for forwarders, that's the file efficiency, the ability to be able to transact a lot at the lowest possible cost per shipment. And that's where we can make a difference. I think all forwarders probably today have the challenge that if the only thing they provide is a booking service with a carrier, then I think that's going to be a hard place to be because of digitization, because it is already very easy to make a booking. But I'm sure most of all our forward customers are much more integrated in the supply chains of their customers. So I think that's where the focus will be, on providing value there.
So do you see yourself then going after some business that some forwarders have today, but not all business that all forwarders have?
Look, if our customers want to book, if BCOs want to book directly with us, that's fine. If they want to use a forwarder, that's equally fine. That is as simple as that. I don't have any target in that respect. And we don't segment our customers in that way either. We segment our customers in accordance with the needs that they have.
Yep. Okay. When you look at again, this question of how you're able to provide value, one of the big differentiators between you and the freight forwarder market is that you're asset based. They're for the most part non-asset based. What are you, as an asset based provider, able to provide the customer that a non-asset company cannot do or has a harder time doing?
So on the one hand, you have a forwarder that can book with any carrier and therefore can make a lot of sailings. And what you get from Maersk, if you deal with us with an end-to-end solution, then you're getting one throat to choke, if you will. And that's the difference between an asset provider and a forwarder.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So the you were here six years ago. You were on this very same stage. Actually, the stage was over there at that point. We moved the stage this year. I don't know if you remember
amazing.
That. Actually, more complicated than you think. when you gave your speech in 2013, you outlined a customer charter, and in that customer charter, you made a number of commitments to the market. And maybe what we could do is go through just a few of them, and we can, now it's 6 years later, so you can say how you're doing against that. Okay, so one of your commitments that you made here in 2013 was confirm all bookings within 2 hours instead of the current average of 2 hours and 58 minutes.
Yeah, I mean, at the time it was seemed like an impressive commitment to make. I mean, today we are well below 1 hour in average, and we are moving to instant booking confirmation within this year, actually probably within the first half of this year.
So the first half of this year, you will have instant booking confirmations on all bookings?
Yes.
And that means,
I think if you're a special danger cargo or dangerous cargo or something like that, I might not be entirely correct. But for any kind of like standard business.
So would it be like an airline? You're booking an airline ticket.
Yes.
It's instantaneous.
Yes.
First half of this year.
Yes. So what we already have is, as I mentioned earlier, so for all our contract customers, of course, their contracts are online and they can book against those rates. And if it's spot business, you'll also get an instant price quote, and you can make a booking against that. That's this year.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's, well, it's actually already out there.
Okay. All right. We'll give you credit for that one. That sounds like progress. And that's actual progress. Okay.
Let me say, though, that I don't think that any carrier will be able to build a long-lasting competitive advantage by being able to accept a booking and give a price instantly, just like when you do book an airline ticket. I think it will become table stakes within the foreseeable future for our industry.
Yeah, so you would expect other carriers will follow suit. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, okay. All right, so another one was complete documentation with 95% accuracy within 8 hours. The current back then was 92% within 12 hours.
Hmm. I think we had 2.5 hours now or something like that.
So you've come down from 8 hours down to 2.5 hours.
Yes.
To complete documentation with 95% accuracy.
Yes.
Okay.
And it's the reason for why we cannot do it faster is because there's information that we're missing. And, our ambition is to get below 1 hour.
Okay. And when do you think you can get to that point?
2019.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. All right. That's a good one. All right. And then the third one, because we could go through all of them, but...
Please, spare them.
Spare them.
There's one of them on the list that we haven't made, but if you could figure out which one it is, then I'll give you credit.
How about we post it as a poll, and we'll let people vote, and we'll see if they can guess. Okay, so then the third one would be complete amendments to documentation within 1 hour. The current average is 96% within 3 hours.
Yeah, I can't remember the stats, but that's the one that we haven't made.
Okay. All right. Well, when are you going to fix that one?
Soon, I hope.
Soon. Okay. All right. We'll get the team on it right away. Okay. Well, that's good. I mean, it's been, 6 years is a, that's plenty of time. So it sounds like you've made progress over that time. So if we were to just move on to a couple of other topics, and then we can move on to some questions, too. We've been talking, obviously, a lot about IMO this year, big topic at the conference this year. We had Dan Juergen, the Pulitzer Prize winning author of the prize, who's the vice chairman of IHS Market. He talked to us yesterday, said that he thought that it was going to be a vote for the, he was talking broadly for the oil industry overall, and he said that it's going to be disruptive, not just for shipping, but because it's going to have spillover effects into diesel fuel prices, and this is why the politicians are now beginning to get worried about it. How do you see this playing out over the next, year and a half, say?
First of all, I have to start by saying that moving the shipping industry to low sulfur fuel is a good thing. I mean, the high sulfur fuel that we burn today, called respiratory diseases and acid rain, it pollutes a lot. And I think we will all be better off as we move to a cleaner fuel. Obviously, it seems like there's a significant cost issue. And if the current projections are correct, then Maersk is looking at a $2 to $2.5 billion higher fuel bill. And that means that the industry, just on the container side, is looking at $10 to $15 billion on that. And obviously, given that the industry, on average, is not making any money, that it's just not possible unless prices go up. So that's why I expect that you'll see quite some focus on adjustable fuel clauses in the contracts this year. How long this extra bill will be this big, I'm a little bit unsure about. Reality is that it doesn't cost $200 to $300 per ton more to refine the fuel to low sulfur from high sulfur. So these projections of the prices, of course, are also very much taking into account what is going on the supply side, so on the refinery side. And if you create enormous demand for a new product, then in the short term you're probably going to see some refineries have a pretty good year or two, but over time I would expect that the price difference to where we are today will come down significantly.
Mm-hmm. So really what we could be looking at is a, and I think that this was what Dan was saying too, he didn't seem to be saying that there would be a long-term impact. He seemed to say that there would be a short-term shock to the system followed by a gradual return to a normalcy.
Yeah, no, I mean, at the end of the day, we're not going to burn more fuel than we do today. The world is still going to burn the same amount of fuel, so why should the prices dramatically change unless it's something that can be explained with a supply side effect? And that's probably how we see it today, that the refineries will have a great time for a while, and then they're going to invest to get capacity up, and then, you know, prices will normalize. That would be my scenario.
Yeah. And what do you say? You know, one of the themes that was in the discussion yesterday was that, you know, carriers have not. Here, Soren, there's a message for you there. The theme was, well, you know, carriers have not been successful in the past passing on the price of higher fuel prices of any kind. Just look at the earnings last year. You know, the 2018 earnings that carriers are now reporting. Blaming profitability issues on higher fuel prices, which implicitly means that they did not recover the cost of higher fuel. Is that going to be a concern for the industry? And could it, if the industry is not able to recoup the higher costs, might the industry have to resort to other actions in order to achieve the revenue necessary to not go bankrupt?
So what I would expect here is that for the contracts, which are give and take 50% of what we do, then the contracts will all have fuel adjustment clauses. I would be surprised if any of our competitors would be willing to sign long-term deals without any visibility to what happens to the fuel price. But who knows? But that would be my that would be my expectations. Of course, the spot market, the spot rates, they're not set based on the fuel price. They're set based on supply and demand. And there, of course, anything can happen. Given if the projections in terms of fuel cost were to come true, then and we don't pass on that to the customers, then more people will go bankrupt. And it's just going to drive more consolidation in the industry. We already had quite a lot of consolidation, and even so, we have carriers that haven't made any money for the last 7-8 years. So if you suddenly have $100, $500 or $1 billion worth of more fuel bill, I mean, it's just not doable. So you know, it could get ugly, but it will lead to more consolidation.
Yeah, and do you think that more consolidation is inevitable in the industry, even taking this issue out of the discussion?
Yes.
See, you can say a lot in one word. So let's just talk, and then we'll get, this will be my final question that I ask you, but then I know there's some excellent questions that I know that have come in from Slido, and thank you all very much for those. You know, you announced last year a very ambitious goal to achieve carbon neutrality by 2050, which is a ways away, of course, but you also said that to achieve this goal, that carbon neutral vessels must be commercially viable by 2030, which actually is not very far away. But in saying that, you did not say how you thought that would be achievable. What you said was that there needs to be more urgency around technology development and so forth. But it does lead to the question, how in 11 years or is it going to be possible to achieve a carbon neutral vessel? Are we talking going back to the days of sail?
No, I think if we are to achieve that, then the most realistic solution is that we either find a biofuel that can replace the current fossil fuel, so low sulfur fuel, or we find a solution around, for instance, hydrogen and or something like that. So a fuel that can be created with electricity also, so an e-fuel of some kind. So that would be, if we are to reach those goals on that kind of timeline, then that's where that's where the solution in most likely will lie. We thought in Maersk that that the IMO has announced an ambition to have 50% reduction in CO2 emissions by 2050 on a 2007 or 8 baseline. But we have already achieved 43% on that baseline, so we felt that a 50% target in 30 years wasn't that aggressive a target for us. So that's why we went all the way and said we want to be carbon neutral in 2050.
And just
the mathematics of it is, of course, that we own the ships for give and take 20 years. So if we want to have a fleet of ships in 2050 that is carbon neutral, then we have to start replacing the current fleet in 2030 in order to, you know, to be there in 2050. Mm-hmm. That's basically the math.
Yeah. So we're really over the next seven years, we're really looking at a period of it seems extremely intense innovation.
Yes, and this is not something we can solve alone. I mean, we need to collaborate with fuel providers. We need to collaborate with engine manufacturers. We need to collaborate with anybody who can help us just get energy consumption down, so that the amount of energy we have to create in order to propel the ship becomes less. So that many people will have to come together to make this happen.
Is it going to become it's one thing to have good values and to be, supportive of, the environment, but is there a commercial reality behind this also, in the sense that our customers, our consumers beginning to, how quickly do you see consumers wanting to look at the environmental quality of their supply chain buying, any consumer item?
Well, I think, first of all, a lot of our customers concern themselves about fuel or CO2 emissions and push us to do better, and rightfully so. And, of course, that's because of a consumer demand for less energy-intense global logistics chain. I don't think we as Maersk can, long-term develop a sustainable competitive advantage. We're not looking to create, our own propulsion technology that is proprietary. Certainly not. I think if the technologies develop, then they will be available for everybody.
Okay, great. So I'm going to move to some questions here. So some good ones that are here. Some easy ones, some tougher ones. So I'm not sure how tough this one is, but I'll ask it anyway. So detention and demurrage. Shippers have had to pay much higher detention and demurrage in the last year, especially after the volume started to pick up. Due to the China tariffs, what is Maersk doing to reduce detention and demurrage fees that customers are paying?
What we're doing to
reduce the detention and demurrage fees that customers have to pay.
And not a lot, actually.
Yeah. Is there anything that you can do?
I think what we can all do, and what certainly we feel that we have a responsibility to do, is to figure out how to become more efficient in the ports in North America, so that we can move the goods faster through the terminals. And I think that's really where we can make an effort.
Do you think the terminals are capable of achieving that?
Well, if you look at the data in the last 6 months, then obviously, as we saw the surge in freight volumes because of the, front loading of imports, presumably, then the terminals were not really able to deal with that in a good way. And the question is, of course, how much can you expect a terminal should have in terms of slack capacity in order to deal with an unexpected surge? But I do think there are things we can do in the way we organize ourselves that can make things more efficient.
Okay, great. Here's a good one. What keeps you and your board up at night when you look 5 to 10 years in the future?
Well, I mean, we are in an industry which, from a financial perspective, has not really been sustainable for the last basically 7 or 8 years, and and that has led to a lot of consolidation in the industry. It's also, you know, impacted by digitization trends and so on. So you know, making sure that we also have a viable business 5 years or 10 years from now is the most important question. How do we organize? Do we need to consolidate more? Should we invest more in digital? These are some of the questions. And with digital comes also even more cyber risk. The more we make our business model dependent on transacting with our customers in an online way, the more we expose ourselves also to cyber risk. So these are really the big questions for us.
Yeah, and obviously cyber risk is an issue that you guys in particular have some experience.
We have experience.
How comfortable are you that you're protected against that kind of attack again or another attack?
Look, when we had the cyber attack in 2017, we learned a lot that we didn't know before. And of course, we engaged with the world's best experts on cyber risk. And one of them said to me, there are two kinds of companies in the world, those that have been hacked and those that don't know they have been hacked. And I think it's unrealistic to assume that we can have a cyber strategy that means that we will never be hacked. But our strategy builds on three things. It builds, first of all, on building the defenses as high as we possibly can. And I can tell you they are much higher now than they were in 2017. We really spent a lot of money, a lot of time and effort in terms of improving our cyber resilience. But it's state actors out there. So assuming that you can build your defenses so high that nobody will ever come over them, that's naive. The second element in the strategy is that we want to be able to do a much better job than we did in 2017 in terms of isolating incidents. So the big problem for us in 2017 was not that we were hacked, it can happen, but it was that we were not able to isolate it to the geography where we were hacked, but it went global. And you know, we moved very much towards having much better capability in that area so that if we are hacked, then it becomes a problem. Ideally for that one computer, but certainly for that country or that region, and not something that goes global. Yep. And then the third element in the strategy is really to be able to rebuild. Because even if we have the two first lines of defense, if you will, if a government wants to hack you, they can do that. And it can be an unintended consequence as something else, any different that is going on. Then we also need the ability to rebuild faster. That's the third element. So we took about 2 weeks to rebuild the whole estate. We threw out 50,000 PCs, bought new ones, and built the whole thing up from ground. And I would like to be able to do that in 2 hours or 2 days, if it ever were to be able to happen again.
Yeah, and there was a strong suggestion, was there not, that there were state actors involved in the last attack that you folks were subjected
Absolutely, yes.
Which is an entirely different.
I don't think it was an attack against us, but we were caught in the crossfire, if you will.
Yeah, got it. So it was mentioned yesterday that the era of mega carriers, I think it refers to mega ships, is over. Do you agree? And what do you think is the optimal vessel size going forward?
I agree that we don't see ourselves building bigger ships than what we have today. So the, you know, what you call 18,000, 19,000, 20,000 TU ships, they're all 400 meter long, 59 meter wide. I mean, I think that's probably as big as the ships are going to be for the foreseeable future. I kind of liken it a little bit to, you know, what you have seen in the airline industry, where you had, you know, you actually had the jumbo jet, the 747, since the late 60s, a 350 to 400 seater plane, as the biggest plane out there. Then came the A380, what is it, 10 years ago, and that has actually not been a commercial success. And if you look at the markets around the world where you can deploy 18,000 TU ships in a meaningful way, there are not that many. Actually, it's only in Asia, Europe. So, and Asia, Europe is not growing, so, you know, why would you want to build a bigger ship? You still want to offer both low cost, but you also want to offer frequency and a reasonable transit time. Yeah. So if we build a 25,000 or 28,000 TU ship, which is entirely possible, it would mean that we would have to compromise on the number of sailings or the transit time, because you would need to call all ports along the way to fill it up.
Yeah, okay, good. In terms of your the end-to-end capability that we were talking about before, how do you, to what degree will partnerships and also acquisitions become an element as you build out your strategy?
But in order to deliver an end-to-end service, we have to work with lots of parties to make that happen. Certainly on the inland transportation side, we are not planning to acquire any railroads or trucking companies or anything like that. So a partner model will be a big part of what we plan to do.
Where do you think the focus of your acquisitions will be?
I mean, we would certainly like to do more in supply, what we call supply chain management, which is basically helping our customers manage, the purchase orders that and the consolidation that they need in the point of origin. That's an interesting area for us. We do have customs house brokerage capability in around 30 countries around the world today, and this is, if you want to offer an end-to-end solution, you probably need to have that capability. So there could also be, small acquisitions.
Yeah.
But at least for now, I'm not looking to do, any big multi-billion dollar transactions.
So you won't be.
We have enough on our plate. We still, we acquired Hamburg Süd for $4 billion, a little more than $4 billion at the end of 2017, and we're still in the process of integrating that. So it's not like we're not busy with what we already have.
Okay, so you won't come to help Panalpina not be acquired by DSV?
I think I can say yes, that's correct.
Okay, good. So this is a more of a tough question. Why does Maersk treat BCOs with less than 5,000 TEUs like peasants? Do they not realize that the shipper is bigger than they think? I'm not sure I understand the question. I think you're saying, do they not realize that that's an important segment of the market? And maybe you disagree with the premise.
First of all, I don't think necessarily that the premise is true here, but obviously, as a carrier, I think all carriers has over the last 20, 25 years, maybe 30 years, in a way, said that we'll let the forwarders should serve the small and medium sized enterprises. Because we don't have the ability to do it, we don't have enough people and so on. I think it's changing though. I mean, at the end of the day, everybody today can get a price online on Maersk.com. Everybody can make a booking online on Maersk.com. So if you want to do that, you can certainly do that too.
Yep. Okay, good. And then just another question, probably the last question. We're really rapidly running out of time. I always think that 45 minutes is not enough time. How about the next time we do this, we talk for 2 hours?
I think there's going to be a half-empty room by
then. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe we can test it out and see if you're right.
No.
What do you think about this was another question, the Transpac market this year, the Trans-Pacific outlook. We're now at the beginning of the contract cycle, we're at the beginning of the year, the backlogs are beginning to clear out from all the unexpected volumes that poured in advance of the threatened tariffs. U.S. is still pretty strong. How does it look?
Well, I think you just kind of answered the question there. I mean, these are the factors. U.S. economy is still doing really well, and I think the economic data that I see suggests that, certainly no discussion about recession this year or next year, not even probably. And so the economy is doing well. Lots of low interest rates, real estate markets okay. A lot of employment. Tax savings and so on. So lots of good things going on. So I guess the American consumer will do a good job this year. Obviously, there's a price to be paid for all the preloading of cargo that came in last year because of the tariff increases. We cannot really separate the hot and the cold water, how much of the import surge was due to just a basic strong economy and how much was due to front-loading of cargo to avoid tariffs. But there must be some of it. Anecdotally, also our customers tell us that. So that must have a negative impact on volumes in the early part of the year here, I would assume. Mm-hmm. But other than that, generally a pretty good situation. Supply and demand is fairly well balanced, and good growth. So yeah. All of this, of course, assumes that U.S. and China eventually will do a new trade deal and we move on. Because if not, then of course we have a new situation.
And what about on the capacity side? Last year carriers were in this market. Other markets might have been different, but in the Transpac, they were disciplined on capacity, withdrew capacity mid-year, never put it back, even though added a number of extra loaders, but still haven't put back that capacity that was put back. I mean, are you expecting carriers to be, or carriers like Maersk, to be cautious or conservative in regard to deployments this year?
I mean, we are not, as Maersk, we are not really getting any new capacity overall this year. We are just around 4 million TEU of capacity, and we'll be around that number for the rest of the year. And of course, we'll try to deploy our network where our customers need the capacity and move it around the world to make that happen. I think last year actually showed quite well how, everybody got served. There was a lot of huge surge, unexpected, in terms of volumes, and the industry, I believe, just to Southern California deployed something like 18 extra loaders and so on, not just Maersk, but the whole industry. So I'm sure that if the cargo is there, then it'll also get served.
Yep, great. We see those zeros on the clock there. That means that we've expired the time that we have together. So on behalf of all of us at the JOC and IHS Market, and on behalf of everyone here, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. Is there any final message that you wish to impart?
Well, as I always say, I really enjoy being here at TPM. It's great to be in roomfuls of people that actually do global trade, facilitation of trade, logistics, and so on for a living. I think globalization has gotten a little bit of a bad rap in recent years, and I think that's entirely unfair. I mean, the case is very strong for job creation, for wealth creation, for consumption opportunities, and we bring all these goods to the markets in a very efficient and extremely low cost way, and I think we should celebrate that a little more.
Yep, agreed. Great, Soren. How about a nice round of applause for Soren Skou? Thank you.